Hi.
Hi.
I'm a former employee of St. Joseph's Hospital, and I knew that I had a pension available to me at some point, but I never mailed in the application. And I heard you say tonight that that application, if they're mailed in now, are going to be preserved, but they won't be processed. So what I'm wondering is there even a benefit to my group mailing those in? Or are we one of the groups that you're going to identify before the courts on October 11th? Or is it just futile for us at this point?
From what I've been told, and I don't know this for certain, but from what the benefits administrator told me, is that your benefits are calculated as of the day that you apply. So if you were to file your application, they will, for lack of a better way to put it, they will date stamp it so that we know when you filed it, so that your benefits, if the court ultimately lifts, when the court ultimately lifts the postponement on processing of those applications, your application will be preserved and treated as if it were received and processed on the date that you had submitted it.
So then we should mail them in.
So if you believe that it's beneficial to you to preserve a date today,
I have it with me, so it's connected. Then you should
mail it in
tonight, but then when I heard you say that, I said, well, maybe it's just not even worth it.
So to the extent that there's a benefit of getting it in now as opposed to a month from now or 2 months from now, I would recommend sending it in.
Okay.
With the understanding that its place in line will be preserved.
Okay. And are we one of the groups that you're going to identify before the quest on October 11th?
There won't be, as far as my hope, is that the groups that are identified will in some way cover every single person who's impacted here. Union, non-union, retired, not retired, everybody's vested. So the groups that I create will be, or that I ask the court to create is a more appropriate way to say it, will be the groups that I believe encompass the entire group of participants and place them in similarly situated couplings.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
I was wondering if the diocese has completely washed their hands of any responsibility or any more responsibility, or have they made any overtures towards making a deposit into the fund?
No.
Mike, if you'd like to answer.
You know,
we don't know behind the scenes.
Sir, if you look at the a recent edition of the Rhode Island Catholic, the bishop, in his own words, has said, not only do they have no financial responsibility, they have no moral responsibility. So if you wonder why we're protesting so much against the diocese and the bishop, it's because he, in his own words, has said that they have no moral responsibility.
But he's going to pray for you all.
Yes. Right. But the hammer could come down on them also, and then he might do a plea bargain and offer something.
At this time, it's uncertain what the diocese would or wouldn't do, or even if they would be the subject of a claim. We are looking into all of that. I did read the article that Jack had just mentioned, or the letter that he had mentioned, and I can tell you that my communication with the diocese has been minimal at this point.
Hi. Just for the record, I'm not one of the oldies. In September 8th, you asked Judge Stern to give you subpoena rights to subpoena the records. I'm assuming that you've been doing that up to this point. And can you shed any light on legally? I mean, it's all well and good that we can go after people morally. I think my question is, what are we doing legally? Is there anybody that we can point the finger at right now to
say legally,
negligence?
We have been obtaining records without subpoenas so far. And we've been inundated just with those. There's a lot of records. What I'm not going to do, and ultimately, I suppose Mr. Del Sesto, my client, will have something to say about this, but we don't intend to report from day to day as to what directions we're going in. I mean, you don't, if you have a lawyer who's working for you, you don't want him announcing publicly all the steps he's making to get you a result. So I just want to make that clear. I do reserve the right to keep things close to my chest until we're ready to let it all. I hope everybody understands that.
So legally, we're moving into a direction where, you know, you've subpoenaed Angel Pension, you've subpoenaed the minutes to meetings.
We've not issued any subpoenas yet. We have asked for records so far voluntarily.
And they've given
a lot of things.
And they've given up those records.
The ones that we've requested. And that's been plenty of a job for us to try to digest.
Right. I'm sure.
So I assure you that as we get into this thing, we are going to subpoena records. Even when they're ready to give them to us voluntarily, we're going to want somebody to show up and authenticate them to make sure we've got all of the records. But I'm going back to this issue that you asked, which is, you know, when are we going to know if we have a case or we don't have a case? And the answer is when we think we can announce it. We're not going to give progress reports to the other side as we do it. You can understand. So I don't know if that's a good answer or what.
Well, it's a lawyer's answer.
Well, I'm a lawyer. But try to be more precise if you can.
In other words, the St. Joseph Services of Rhode Island Incorporated, they had a board.
Yes.
Boards have meetings.
Yes.
Have they given up their...
Speak into the mic.
Have they given up the board, the minutes of their meetings? Have they given up...
Not all of the minutes of the meetings yet. We've gotten certain things from them, and we're trying to understand what we've got. This is, like, enormously complicated, and I assure you, we've devoted an enormous amount of time in the limited period and I haven't even been formally hired yet. So, and I hope that's going to happen in the next few days. So, the answer is, believe it or not, we are anxious to get to the bottom of this. But you've got to, you don't
really
have to do anything. But I'm asking you to give us some time to get on top of this. It is very complicated.
No, I understand. Thank you. Sorry.
Sorry.
I started a Facebook group to get everybody notified of anything that we could find out. So we have the older children being represented by Arlene Violet. We have the younger child being represented by the union. But then there's this middle child that's not quite at that Social Security age. But if it takes as long, if you find funds to get that money, I could be in her group in a matter of 3 or 4 years. So this middle child, when you present to the judge if he could recommend getting a lawyer to represent us, is there a way that could be pro bono, or are we paying for this? Because we're not quite at the middle of our career, we're at the tail end. We held off getting our Social Security, even though we could have, but we held it off because we were told the money will be there. The longer you wait, the more money you'll get per month. I could have gotten it at 55. I chose not to because I was told if you wait a little longer, you'll get more money. You know, a lot of us take care of ourselves. We'll be in those shoes with Arlene Violet in a matter of a couple of years. So when you do these groups, you know, please consider the almost children in that category, because I worked 40 years, you know.
I am considering that. I can tell you there won't be just three. It won't be the oldest, the middle, and the youngest. There will be multiple groups. With regard to who the court will ultimately identify, designate, I'm not sure how the judge will want to do it. We haven't gotten there yet. I can't speak to whether or not whatever counsel are identified or designated, whether they will be doing it pro bono or at a reduced rate or anything like that. I'm certain that the court will request that they do the best that they can. But as I stand here right now, I do not know what the result of that will be or whether or not there will be a charge or something like that.
Gentleman who came up, Stephen Fernandez, and he said he would work with the middle group or whoever pro bono, so maybe there's a way to get in touch with him for this.
I know Attorney Fernandez well.
He and others have all contacted me and said, if you need my help, I'm available for the judge's consideration. So I will be letting the judge know, and the judge will make a determination as to what he thinks is most appropriate.
So, if pro bono too.
Okay.
So, at what point can the middle child get that information, or do you have to present that to the judge first?
In terms of those groups, I've got to present that to the judge, and if the court designates, as I stated in the beginning, anybody here is free to engage whatever counsel they want if they believe it's in their best interest. It's my hope that the court will identify these groups and identify counsel because it'll be much easier to deal with five or six attorneys representing five or six large groups than dealing with 50 attorneys identifying small groups.
Right.
At this point, I can't tell you not to engage counsel or not.
Well, then if I do engage counsel individually, I'll definitely be in that pauper group.
Okay.
You're in your money, but
it's my intention to present something to the judge on the 11th, so we're about 9 days away on that.
So at that point in time, after you present, you will notify us by mail if there is an email posting on your website, if there is a lawyer representing that middle.
If the judge identifies groups and identifies counsel, I will be sending notification to everybody, whether you've already spoken to Arlene and fall in that group or the union, so that you're aware of the judge's actions.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. I got another question. From what I understand, you read and everything, that the church didn't put in money at certain times or enough money what they should have been putting in. Since we were unionized, at least the RNs were, okay, if they didn't keep up their part of the contract, could you get the National Labor Board involved in that for them because there was a contract?
No, the Labor Board's not going to have anything to do with it.
Okay.
All right, that's the simple answer.
Okay, so you have a contract. They didn't fulfill their contract. We'll say there's a chance of them not fulfilling the contract.
The remedy's going to have to be through this process and not through the Labor Board. It's going to have to go through this process.
Okay.
It's still going to have to go through this process for the simple reason is that right now the employer doesn't exist, so it has to go through this process to get to them. In other words, if right now it was the St. Joseph's Health Services that was dealing with the plan, it might be a different issue, but they have been out of it for several years. That's why it's going to have to go through this process.
Can I ask something about that? It's like if they don't exist, however, like the other girl said, and I mentioned at the other meeting, they were one of the sellers of St. Joe's on P Street. I said it at Arlene's meeting. It said that St. Joe's on P Street, all that property, the big hospital, their parking lot, huge parking lots on either side, were sold for $99,000. The sellers were Prospect, Charter Care, St. Joseph Health Services, Inc., LLC. So evidently, they existed when they want to exist. How could they sell that for $99,000? The parking lots themselves, this was negligent. They knew the pension was being malfunded, underfunded, because Angel was telling them this. How could they be one of the sellers? The parking lot themselves, don't you think someone that worked downtown would pay $5 a day to park their car there and take the buses. There's something funny in there. I said that before. There is something funny. I think it's, that's our money. 99 miles and that sold for. $50 million. They were one of the sellers. Said, you can look at it like a Trojo. St. Joseph Health Services, Rhode Island, Inc., or whatever, LLC. I don't know what LLC. What does that mean, LLC? I don't know what it means.
Limited liability company. And you haven't seen anybody claim more limited liability than these people. But let me address this. One of the things that makes this case so frustrating is the similarity of names for these various entities. Now, in 2014, the old hospital, we should kind of agree on the terms, what we're talking about, because the name St. Joseph continues. And the hospital that you all worked for back before the 2014 sale, substantially all its assets, including that real estate, were sold out. So the transaction that you're talking about now is not from the old hospital. The old hospital, as Mr. Del Sesto said, is essentially a shell corporation. It lost all, I shouldn't say lost, it gave away all its assets. We will look into it, but the way you describe it makes it sound very, very straightforward and very simple. And unfortunately, it's not. It's more complicated. But I assure you, it's a very good and very legitimate question. But what's happened here is very confusing just to figure out who's who with the similarity of the names. There's like at least three companies with the name CharterCare in it. And there's multiple companies with St. Joseph. And part of the problem is straightening all that. We will get to the bottom of that.
This is like a job for Perry Mason.
It is. Well, you get and then we. Well, you can be Della Street if my memory serves.
Just a statement. They find out the church didn't put into our pension. Deliberately, sue the hell out of them.
I'd like to make an observation. I'm not sure if you can comment on this or not, but in reviewing the events and the statistics related to the demise of the pension plan, as reported, it's based on the fact that there was a 90% funding level, an accuracy of 90%. That means if there was $100 million in pension owed or $90 million in assets, we have 90%. It couldn't possibly go to 60% in 2 years. And the other thing is, at 90%, if that was the funding level then, it was doomed to failure automatically, and everybody would have known that. How the hell did it ever go through? It makes no sense to me. Mm-hmm. And whether or not there's been mismanagement thereafter, I don't know, but I would look back to that original agreement. Who were the parties to it? How was it made? Was there any intentional misrepresentation? You can manipulate financial numbers very easily to result in a different actuarial outcome. I think this is the crux of the whole issue.
As you state, we're looking into that transaction. There are also that 90% number. It's very, very confusing as to what that meant when it was represented, what people thought it meant. Or were representing it meant. It's a complicated question. Those are all parts of that transaction and what has resulted in the pensions problems today that we're looking into.
I mean, at the very least, if you're discontinuing funding, you should have been funded at 100% in an accurate 100%.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, a lot of attention has been paid to the 2014 date. I'm under the assumption that most of this is about the defined pension plan. And Saturday was the anniversary, the 8th anniversary of September 30th, 2009. That was the end of the defined pension plan. Starting October 1st, 2009, it went to her 403B. Every paycheck, the employees had money taken out for the 403B. The hospital was supposed to match it every quarter, every 3 months.
In the 403B. At that point, we were told that we had to, we could not do it if you were union, and we would not get anything because we had the defined pension. Anybody that was there prior to that and had been vested prior to that were not allowed to do the other.
Okay, I guess I'm not talking about nurses then. I mean, my wife is not in the union. But, as far as I recall, anyway, as of, for the non-union people, as of September 30th, 09, the defined pension ended for them. And when my wife went to retire in July of 2013, she found out that the hospital hadn't made their deposit for 5 quarters, okay? So they, and then she had to wait until November for them to catch up on 2013 deposits. Okay, enough of that. I just got to go on with this other thing here for Arlene. The reason your 99-year-old example, the pension plan was based on the highest 5 consecutive years during the 10 final years, and then the biggie was no cost of living. So somebody that's been retired for 30 years is getting the same money that they were getting, but cost of living's gone up in 30 years. Yeah. And the other thing was the actuarial tables. Years back, I worked with insurance, and they haven't changed that much, plus or minus 4 or 5 years maybe in the last 50 years. You know, you don't have any Methuselahs around, but... And the other biggie was people retiring, or the rule of 85, age 55 plus 30 years of working. So if you go to work at 20 or 25, work 30 years, you're age 55, technically you could apply for the defined pension and continue working. And I don't know how many people did that, but it was in the pension plan. But one final thing, anybody, this gentleman that mentioned investing, most people invest in mutual funds, not individual stocks. The whole concept being that some go up, some go down, Standard & Poor's 500, whatever. Since 2014, the Dow has gone up approximately 5,000 points in the last 3.5 years. I don't know, Angel Pension Group or whoever, who's handling it, but if they're investing in mutual funds, the average should have gone up. And based upon what happened last night in Las Vegas, anytime there's a significant social event or something, it affects the stock market. You could see a crash, you could see a, easily see a crash of 1,000 points within a week. What happens is a 2,000 or 3,000 point crash. How's that going to affect the return on the investment? So, okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
The 403 plan, we had to switch it over to a 401 because it went from profit, not profit, to profit.
To a
that's
profit.
Why there's no more investment.
That's correct.
Hi, my name is Carol Liberace. I worked in X-ray for 27 years. I got let go from the hospital just after they joined up with Prospect. In this, I've been keeping track of all the articles in the papers ever since this blew up. And August 22nd, just a few things here I wanted to reread. Since the receivership petition, none of the current or former managers of St. Joseph have acknowledged any responsibility for the plight facing pensioners. The Roman Catholic Diocese of Providence wrote in a statement, it should be noted that no action by the diocese resulted in the filing of this receivership. In fact, it is our understanding that the acquisition of the hospitals by Prospect Charter Care in 14 left the pension funds in a very strong position. Further on, it says, Otis Brown, a spokesman for Charter Care, says, It's important to note that the pension fund is not connected to either Charter Care, Health Partners, or Prospect. So whose is it? Okay? And asked what, this was the clincher, this has been stuck in my mind ever since I read it. Asked what has gone wrong since 2014, Richard Land, an attorney representing St. Joseph Health Services of Rhode Island in the matter, said it was complicated and declined to assign blame. Now, I just, that's to me is an insult to call it complicated. Like the average person can't begin to understand what it had to do. So I'm very glad that Mr. Wistow is with us. I've heard good things about you. And I, now that I've heard you speak, I'm very glad that you're in charge here. Very glad to hear you for the union. Harvey, Violet. I'm not sure who you are, but... But everybody up here, I'm glad that you guys are up here and that something's going to be done. So thank you very
much. Thank you.
Can you come up to the mic? Come up to the mic.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm in the middle group. So my understanding was, and I just want to make sure that I've got this correctly, I don't have to hire a lawyer right at this point, because we're waiting to see what comes up from what you're investigating and all of that first. Is that correct? Or should I be thinking of something like that now to keep myself covered? Because I don't want to be left out in the dark. I don't think a lot of us do.
Right.
So what is your recommendation for that?
That's a difficult question. you certainly have the right to inquire to hire an independent attorney. As I stated, it's my intention to go to the judge on the 11th and identify groups and ask the judge, either me make recommendations or the judge make independent assessment himself as to attorneys that should be assigned to those groups. You aren't obligated. If you are identified as a group C, you aren't obligated to retain the attorney who's been designated for Group C. You can always hire your own independent counsel.
Okay.
At this point, and I think, I can't remember if Max said it or somebody said it, we haven't identified yet what could be coming back into the plan.
Right.
If anything.
Right.
And until we do that, it's the discussion of who should get what is really, at this point, not going to happen until January or February, at the earliest.
Okay.
So until there is a determination on benefits, which is really what is going to impact you the most,
right?
I can't say it's not necessary because I can't speak for what each person here believes
right.
is necessary for them.
Right.
It's my hope that the court will identify people so everybody feels they've got a voice. And once that person is identified and those groups are identified, you'll be able to communicate, if you choose to opt in with that counsel, communicate with that attorney, and they will be the voice of that group.
Can I ask one more question? If by chance this all goes through and the fund is made whole because everybody came up with money and they did with their good diligence and made it whole, do we need a lawyer at that point? That would be settled, wouldn't it?
If that scenario
if that
happens,
happen.
Yeah, I don't want to dampen anybody's mood tonight, but I do feel that it's important to say that it would be an incredible feat on Max's part and everybody's part
right.
if we were able to identify the amount of funds that we will be told are needed to keep this plan alive.
Okay. All right, it's good to just clarify that in my brain here.
I just want to clarify something. No matter what we determine in our minds to be great claims, you know that the other side, whoever that is not necessarily going to roll over and die.
Yeah, right.
And there could be a very extensive and protracted litigation.
Okay.
So it really is unrealistic, I think. Unrealistic is the best word.
Okay.
To assume that somehow we're going to get this straightened out before some kind of adjustment has to be made in the plan. Okay. It's just not in the offing.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
If this, when this all comes to fruition and you approach the judge with your findings, and we have no claims, there are no claims that you can go against, who actually now will be in charge of the remaining pension fund? Will it, you said you could possibly do like a termination of the fund or a winding down. Are you still going to be in charge of that, of all the money that's left over?
I guess theoretically, yes, depending on what the recommendation is. If it's a termination, that would be compared to a long-term wind down. A termination would be relatively quick compared to that. But I will be in place as long as, until the court tells me otherwise, as long as there are funds in this plan to manage and to protect, I will be in place. Yes. Okay. Yes.
I just had a quick question.
Can't hear you.
I just have a very quick question about this, the logistics of this, in terms of, I noticed that there was no, we didn't have to show our letter that we received or anything, so how do we know that everyone in this room, how do we know that there's no one being from the diocese here, or do we know?
Oh, yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
That is.
I feel like
good
point.
To be.
One of the reasons that lawyers dodge and weave and don't answer questions is just because of something like that. So even if I knew something like really good, I can't just disclose it publicly for that reason. So we don't know. If somebody's here from the diocese, welcome, and please go back and do something for all these people.
Well, I'll tell you, know, this was an open public meeting that I called anybody who was interested. I felt was appropriate to be here. I also will tell you this is being recorded this evening, and the purpose of me recording it is because there are many pension holders who do not live in Rhode Island or nearby, and they can't be here the way you are to ask questions. So I've recorded this, and this will go up on the website, so that if you're in Florida or Arizona, you'll be able to see what happened and the questions that were asked.
So I was just wondering, why do you feel the need to have separate groups and us to be categorized in a certain way?
At this point, I don't feel the need to do it. I believe that it is prudent to do so. And the reason for that is, while right now, everybody is focused on what happened mm-hmm. in getting the having those that are responsible, if anybody, mm-hmm. be held accountable for it and hopefully bring more money into the plan. Once that happens, each one of the groups, as you've heard Arlene speak, will have a different interest in what happens. We'll have a different opinion on how cuts should occur and how they should be applied. There's already been the suggestion by St. Joe's Health Services it should be a 40% cut across the board. Arlene had suggested something that's more staggered in terms of where you are in terms of your ability to recoup. There are a myriad of scenarios that can be explored in terms of how to deal with the money that's left in this plan and distribute it to the plan participants. Having those groups is intended to identify those individuals who are similarly situated and would want to see the same result for cuts and give them a voice at the table so that if we have six groups, we have six voices saying, we don't like that idea and this is why.
Then I'd like to go on record as saying I think the only fair thing is, if we have to sustain cuts, it has to be the same for everybody across the board. It has to be. I respect that you're representing people, Arlene, that are in dire financial straits. But what you don't know is, what if that's me 5 years from now, and you took a bigger cut of my pension to take care of somebody else?
You have no idea what anybody's financial situation is, what their circumstances are, and some of these people have already been collecting money, so they got to keep 100% of their pension that they've been collecting for 10, 20, or 30 years. I haven't collected a dime yet. And I just think that there's no way that it can be fairly done on a sliding scale. It can't be done. Please.
The overarching concept is undue hardship. So you can make that case. I merely illustrated that there are some persons who by definition are already in that strait. But that doesn't preclude other groups or individuals from asserting undue influence. That's why it's that broad.
I get it. But like I said, you don't know what's down the road for the rest of us.
Yeah, but you get a chance to petition.
Okay.
You get a chance to make your case of undue hardship.
And I also feel that we've all been told and we need to be united in this and we need to all stand together. And I just see dividing us into these groups and everybody having a different focus of their interests just causes a division.
Just so everybody's aware, I'm maybe about 10 more minutes. We could go on here all night long. I'm happy to get additional questions. After this meeting, of course, the website, the email address, and the phone line are all still available. So if something was not addressed or if you wanted clarification on something that was, you can always do that. But we're going to take just a few more questions and wrap up in about 5-10 minutes.
I have a very quick question. One, was the St. Joseph Hospital pension plan ever commingled with the diocesan pension money? And if it was, how was the separation accomplished?
I'll answer the question in this way. I'm not aware of any commingling. And we'll be looking into everything. And if we see that, then we will address it. But I'm not aware that there was ever a commingling of funds. It's my understanding that these assets were held separate by the custodian and that they were invested separately. But we may find out differently. But as I sit here today, I'm not aware of anything.
Thank you.
If I could just echo what that young lady had just said about need and in terms of once you start to segregate groups, it almost seems like it further convolutes the matter. I was a 23-year employee of St. Joseph's Hospital. My job was eliminated the same time my husband was diagnosed with a terminal illness and passed away last November unexpectedly. My job was eliminated after 23 years. I'm 55. I was told to wait to collect my pension. Now is when I need the pension, but now is when I cannot access the pension. I have a 14-year-old daughter that I'm finding that I have to raise by myself. My only source of income is SSDI from Social Security. Talk about an unexpected event, turning of event. This pension plan being bankrupt and no one culpability seems to be here, there, and everywhere is most unsettling. I tend to agree with the aspect of once you segregate, it seems to dilute the whole benefit. And I'm really pleading and I'm hoping that you will understand the situation that we're all in. And please, culpability has to be somewhere. Please, we beg of you to do something about this. Thank you.
I appreciate your time all being here tonight. I would like to ask Arlene if there is a website where we can call or how can we get in touch with you if we need to?
Marilyn Horan or Penny Spobin have been the conduits. Marilyn has some sheets here that have my contact information and Rob Sendel's contact information.
Thank you.
So it's all there. And let me just, you know, finally say to the women, what this receiver I think is trying to do is to make sure everyone's voice is heard. I was trying to explain who I think we're representing pro bono because they don't have that voice yet. The union does have a voice. We want the people who fall, that are the middle children. I love that expression. Look, you've been orphaned once. the receiver has no intention of making you an orphan again, second child or middle child. That's why he's working with the names and to make that presentation to the judge.
Yeah. One more question, and then we're going to wrap up for the night.
Since we've had these Facebook things, everybody's getting on, I just want to say that, as it's already been stated, we need to stand together. But Facebook is out there for everybody to look at, and some of the comments that I've seen have been less than desirable. The first day that this happened, I made a few comments, and I have since really stayed away from that. I think we need to stay away from saying rotten things about people, or, you know, we need to find out the facts. That's your job. And when we find out, we need to stand together, because we'll look like a bunch of fools if we're all standing and fighting against each other. So I'm sure we all hope that all of you are going to make this as good as you can, and I know you can't probably make it the best that we'll want it, but the best that we can get out of it, whatever that is, we need to stand together. And as a group that we always did, we worked together as a team, and now we should be standing together as a team again.
Thank you. I guess that's a very good comment to end the evening on. I will tell you, and I think I can speak for everybody up here, that everybody up here is extremely bothered by the fact that you are in this position. You do not deserve this. You did not deserve this. And everybody here is going to give their best effort to make sure that this is that this proceeding goes as best as it possibly can. If there's somebody who we can hold accountable, we will. And we will keep you informed, because that's one thing you have not been getting up to this point. And I... Thank you. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. And as I said, if you have follow-up questions, you can utilize all of the mediums that we've set up. Thank you.